second series, we have titled it, The Road to the Resurrection by the Way of Prayer. And we've been looking at the life and the teaching of Jesus Christ. As it was said earlier, we started the journey by talking about the commitment to prayer. And we looked at the prayer life of Jesus and showed how that not only the Son of God, but God the Son was committed to prayer. And, you know, he didn't have to pray. He was with God from all eternity, but he came to this earth. He was dependent on his Father. And he prayed, and he showed us his commitment to prayer. Then last week, we looked at the model prayer, and we said that that was God again when he was asked to teach his disciples how to pray, that God said, this is what you pray. And so we looked at the model prayer last week. Today, we are looking at persistence in prayer. We've had the two scriptures that were read before us today, and we're looking at this whole idea of persistence in prayer. And so the title of my message today is this: the kind of pest that God loves. The kind of pest that God loves is the one who persists in prayer. Where you have lifted up your needs to the Father and you continue to bombard the gates of heaven with your requests. Persistence in prayer, the kind of pest that God loves. What is the meaning of pester? What is the meaning of pester? Pester means to trouble or annoy someone with frequent or persistent requests or interruptions. We've all had it happen to us, those of us who have raised children. And if you've gone on a long trip, they've asked the question 10 minutes into the trip, are we there yet? A half hour later, are we there yet? An hour later, are we there yet? And so they have a knack of continuing to persist in asking the question. So our children could become a pest by asking that question. But God does not look at us as pests when we come to him. There is a phenomenon, and I don't know if you've ever heard of it before, but I'm sure you've experienced it. It's called pester power. Pester power. Let me define what pester power is. It's the nag factor, known as the phenomenon in the U.S. literature, is the tendency of children who are bombarded with marketers' messages to unrelentingly request advertised items. The phrase is used to describe the negative connotations of children's influence in their parents' buying habits. Right? You all seen it. I know it didn't happen to any of y'all, because when you raised your children, you know, they were obedient children that, you know, when you went to the store, you told them, don't ask for anything. Don't ask for anything. And they obeyed you, right? Well, but somebody said, okay, all right. But just think of the power that the media puts on children to want a certain thing, and then they pester their parents until their parents actually end up buying it. When you go to the store, can I have this? No. 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 Can I have this? Okay, here. Go. Come on, good lady. Pester power. How powerful a phenomenon that is, even in our culture. And we can come to God. And again, it's not that we are pestering God until he does what we ask him to do. That's not the question. But the idea is that we have to have the same tenacity. We have to have the same gumption that child has, that when we go to the throne of God, that we will persist in prayer. Again, it's not you're not going to wear God down. I'm going to share with you a little bit later in this message that God loves to hear your voice. He wants to hear your voice, right? And so when you come to him with prayer requests, it's not pestering to twist God's arm to make him do something for you, but you come in consistency. You come in confidence in bringing your prayer requests before God. We see in the scriptures that were read before us today, there are two examples of, in the scripture, of tests. The first one we find is in Luke chapter 11. And in Luke chapter 11, verse 5, we read about the first test. It says, "And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend, and shall go unto him at midnight, and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. And a friend of mine is on his journey, and come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of importunity, because he consistent, because he shamelessly consistent, he will rise and give him as much as he needs." We see the friend who was a pest. Then there's a widow who was a pest. In Luke 18, verses 1 through 5, Jesus spoke a parable unto them to this end, that men ought to pray and not to faint, saying, there was in the city a judge who feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came to him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. And he would not for a while. But after a while, he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard men, because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she wears me out. So we see here two pests in the scripture. And God uses them as examples to us as to how we are to come to him by being persistent in prayer. I've heard people say, just pray something one time. All you got to do is pray it one time. God heard you the first time you prayed it. You don't have to keep praying it over and over again. But that's not what the book says. The book don't say that. The book says, and we're going to look at this a little bit in a second, keep on asking. Keep on seeking. And keep on knocking. And so we walk away from this, not that we come and, yeah, God knows it after the first time you pray it. But God wants you to continue to lift your request up before him. We're going to look specifically today at the friend who was a pest in Luke chapter 11. Now, in Luke chapter 11, if you can go back to the previous slide, in Luke chapter 11, we see Jesus teaches on persistence in prayer. In Luke 11, 1, his disciples came unto him and asked him, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. Oh, man, this is, again, this blew my mind last week, and it's continuing to blow my mind this week. And that is when they ask God, because Jesus is God, when they ask God, teach us how we need to direct, how we need to construct, how we need to come before the Father with our prayers. This is what God said. And so we see here is another version of the model prayer that he gave the disciples, but was all based upon them asking him, God, teach us how to pray. And so in verses 2-4, he gives them the model prayer. And he said unto them, when you pray, say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So here we have another account of the Lord's or the disciples' prayer. And so Jesus jumps right off of that and piggybacks by giving a parable. Right? He just has given them the model prayer, and then he piggybacks right on the back of it by talking about what? Persistence in prayer. There's a lot of directions that he could have went after that. He could have been talking about commitment to prayer. He could have been talking about weariness in prayer. He could have talked about all these other aspects of prayer. But after he gives the model prayer, he goes into a parable on persistence. And you know, you might ask the question, you know, why is it that he would even need to talk about being persistent in prayer? And I'm not too sure back then, but today we need to hear about persistence in prayer. Because I read this, I was reading a sermon on perseverance in prayer by a preacher by the name of Alan Perkins. Let me just share with you some of the things that he said. He said, you and I live in an era of unprecedented speed. Technology, the pace of change is almost incomprehensible. The rule of thumb called Moore's Law states that the speed of the computer chip doubles every 18 to 24 months. He went on to say that even our daily activities, which used to take days or weeks, we now expect to happen instantly. Federal Express delivers packages overnight. LensCrafters can make eyeglasses in an hour. At Walgreens, you can get film developed in an hour. Applying for a loan, which used to take several days, now the banks can approve you within 30 minutes. It's difficult to identify an area of our life that hasn't been accelerated. Microwaves, ATM machines, email, online trading. We've grown intolerant of any kind of delay. We expect to get what we want when we want it. I want it now, now, now. Faster, faster, faster. Hey, have you tried to use a rotary phone lately? Just think, if you tried to use a rotary phone, right, you probably get frustrated when now some of y'all don't even know what a rotary phone is. Right? That's back in the old days. Now you know what, if I want to call my wife, I just say, call Angie Glaze. and it dials her. You know, if somebody whose number I have programmed, I might have to go look it up. Then I just touch it and it dials. Look at this. Very seldom do many of us, I'm not going to say all of us, touch even the numbers, the dial number. Right? You could probably go through days talking to people all day long and you didn't dial the number one time. Why? Because we want it and we want it now. So going back to the rotary phone, right, that's when you had to stick your number in the little hole for the number, and then you pull it all the way around to the bottom, then you took out your hand, and you let it go, and it went all the way back around. And that was just that was just one number. So I can see some of y'all today, right? Dialing. Come on, hurry up. Come on, get back to the truck. So I can dial the next number. So we want stuff. We want it now. And so that becomes even more important why Jesus would have to even teach on being persistent. Because we give up. We don't want to persevere. Now, he concludes this by saying, how about this one? The smallest interval of time scientists have so far identified. No, it's not the millisecond or the nanosecond. It's the honkersecond. And that is the amount of time between when the light turns green and the driver behind you honks his horn. So why does Jesus have to even give us a parable on persistence? Because we are an impatient people. We don't want to persevere. We don't want to continue to stick with the stuff and stay by the stuff until we see our prayer answered. Jesus opens up this passage with a question. And the question that he asks is, which of you that has a friend who shall come at midnight and say unto him, lend me three loaves? For a friend is come on a journey and I have nothing to set before him. Now, the question that he's asking back in this culture would have an obvious no. That, you know, would the friend deny him? No, the question, the answer is no. That it was basic in the culture that if somebody came by, that you had to take care of them. And so in this passage, I want to show you three segments very quickly. Segment number one is coming to the friend at night. And we just read that if you have a friend that comes at midnight and asks for three loaves, you know, then because he has nothing to set before his visitor. Now, many times in Jesus' day, especially in this region of the country, people traveled at night. And the reason they traveled at night, because it was too hot to travel during the day. I remember when I went to Israel. And we went to the Dead Sea, and we went up to Masada, and we rode by Engedi. We didn't get a chance to see Engedi, but we rode by Engedi. And those things were right in the middle of the desert. And the day, and we were there around 11 o'clock, and it was 104 degrees at 11 o'clock in the morning. So it just got hotter during the day. So a lot of people traveled at night because it was too hot to travel during the day. Now, when somebody came, you might ask the question, why did he ask for bread? How come he didn't ask for, you know, some meat, some other things? Well, you remember when Jesus was having the last meal with the disciples, and it said that he dipped the sop. Well, what the sop was bread. And the bread was essential to the meal. And so Jesus would, they obviously had different types of soups and other things that required bread to dip into, and then you would eat it. And, you know, some of y'all taking you back to the day, right? You know what sop is, right? Y'all used to sop it up, right? And so the bread was, the guy might have had, he might have had other things to be able to feed this guy, but the bread was essential. And so he had to go get some bread so that they could eat the sop. And if he said, well, I don't have any sop, you know, and so that therefore the meal would not be complete, and the guy might move on to the next house, and it would be a shame, you know, for him to have this guest come by and not be able to take care of his physical needs. So that's segment one. Then we move on to segment two, which is the refusal to meet the request. In verse 7, and he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. And so the man says, look, you know, we are all settled for the evening. You know how it is that when you go to bed and you get the cover just right, right? You get the right position in the bed. You know where that is, and you get that cover just right. And man, you ready to go call some hogs, man, right? And somebody does something. You got to get up. You know how frustrating that is, man. I found my spot. You know, I got to take my cover off. I got to put my robe on. Got to put my slippers on and get up. Look, man, we already in bed. Why are you going to bother me? And that moves us to segment three. And segment three is persistence. And this is the point that Jesus was making, that persistence pays off. Verse 8, I say unto you, though he will not rise, this man wasn't getting up, though he will not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. Look, he wasn't going to get up because he was a friend, but he was getting up because of importunity. Let me break down this word importunity for you. Let me break down this word. Very interesting word. And you might not catch this in the English, but it comes out, it screams out at you in the Greek. Yet because of importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. Importunity, it comes from this Greek word, anedia. And this is what it means, a sense of shame. A sense of shame. The guest, look at this. And if you go back and you study people who write on Middle Eastern culture of this time, they will verify this. And that is, the guest who came to this man's house was a guest of the village, not just this one person. To not provide food would have brought shame for the whole village. The guests would leave not feeling good about the hospitality of the village, right? Or he would move on to the next house. And maybe the guy at the next house would get up and give him bread. And the guy before didn't want to get up and get out of bed and wake his children. It says, but because of his importunity, that the man in the house didn't want to be shamed. He didn't want him to get up the next day. Man, you know we had a guest in the village. Right? Well, people came to church the next Sunday. Man, did you hear what so-and-so did? That he had a guest come to his house and he came for bread to his friend, and his friend didn't even want to get up and give him bread. Wait a minute. Did you hear what so-and-so did? And that would be the talk of the village. And then the next day, this brother, he'd be coming out, and people would be talking about him. He'd be walking like this. Right? Shameful. So, he didn't get up because the man was his friend. That wasn't enough to get him up. But to realize that he was about to look people in the eye the next day and the shame that he was going to face, the Bible said that he got up. Get on up. He got up. He got up and got the bread. And so we see that Jesus uses this as an occasion to teach persistence in prayer. That the man kept on knocking, and he eventually got up because he didn't want to be shamed the next day. And then in verses 9 and 10, Jesus says this, "I say unto you, ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened." Now I put this chart together that's up on the screen now, and it looks at these two verses in particular. It looks at verse 9 and it looks at verse 10. Verse 9 is in the imperative language, and that means it's a command, almost like a military officer giving a soldier a command. It's a command that's meant to be followed. In verse 9, who's giving the command? It's God giving the command. And God says, ask, seek, and knock. God says that. Yo, Jesus is saying unto them, ask, seek, and knock. It's a command that I'm giving you. It's not something that you can pray about or go and think about or go meditate on, but it's a command that this is what I'm telling you to do. Now we jump to verse 10, and we see in verse 10 the language shifts, right? And even the verb tenses shift, because where verse 9 is a command, verse 10 is what we would call, and you English majors will know this, a participle, which is present action in the continuous action in the present time. We might say this, he was, watch this, right? So, stop. He ran, right? He ran, but watch this. He's what? Oh man, took some of y'all back to high school, right? Right? And so verse 9 is God's command. Verse 10 is our response. He commands us, ask. Our response should be, keep on asking. He commands us to seek. Our response should be, keep on seeking. He commands us to knock. Our response should be, keep on knocking. And so we look at this whole idea of persistence in prayer. So as I kind of tie things together here, I want to ask a couple of questions. The first question I want to ask is, what does it mean to persist in prayer? The second question, how long should a person persist in prayer? And then a third question, what are the benefits of those who persist in prayer? We've already got it from the scripture, saints. You know, we got the foundation from the scripture that we are to be persistent in prayer. It's right there in the book, two times. So there's no question about that. He says to ask. He says to seek. He says to knock. How do we keep on asking? How do we keep on seeking? And how do we keep on knocking? That's the application that we want to look at today. What does it mean to persist in prayer? First of all, it means that you seek the will of the Father. That in prayer, you seek God's heart in prayer. Look at 1 John chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. 1 John chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that are desire of him. Keep on asking. Keep on seeking. Keep on knocking. First of all, you've got to pray and you've got to know the Father's heart. I've said it from this pulpit on many occasions. And you might want to write this. This is, I don't know if I told y'all to tweet this one. This is tweetable, this is quotable, this is Instagrammable, or this is Facebookable, whatever you want to call it. And that is this. No prayer. That's another one. That's another one. All right, y'all got that one down. Yeah, when the next generation comes, and Pastor Glaze has gone home to be with the Lord. You know, Pastor Glaze used to always say, no prayer. All right, but this is another one, right? And it's this. No prayer that starts in heaven is ever rejected when it gets back there. No prayer that starts in heaven is ever rejected when it gets back there. Now again, we don't know what the answer is going to be, but my only point is that if you see the Father's heart, if you say, you know, the disciple said, Lord, teach us to pray. And, you know, he says here, you got to seek God's will. You know, the problem with many of us is that we seek our own will. And we pray for things that we want. And then when it don't happen, we wonder why. The first thing that you got to do when you pray for something is that you got to seek the Father's heart. You got to get in tune with God. You got to put your space in God's space. You got to put your heart in God's heart. And you got to find out where God is working, what God is doing. And then you can persist in prayer. When you got the heart of the Father, when the Father is telling you, I mean, 1 John makes it very clear that this is the record, that God will hear your prayer. Now, again, I'm not saying how he's going to answer it, when he's going to, I'm not saying, that's not my point. My point is that it's gotten through. You know, sometimes we pray, and we pray a lot of prayers that just bounce off the ceiling and come back down. I don't know about you, but I want to know that my prayer is getting through. And if I'm praying the heart of the Father, then I know that he hears me if I'm praying his heart. And I, you know, we talked last week about some things that you got to look out in your life in the model prayer, that there's some things in there that you can't pray, right? If there's sin in your life, if you are not being sensitive to those in need, you know, there's some things that you might not be able to pray. So the first thing, what does it mean to persist in prayer? It means to seek the will of the Father. Secondly, 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. It means you gotta have unbroken prayer. Now, I'm not saying that you gotta walk around 24/7 praying, Father, do this, Father, do this, Father. No, no. But what he means is, in your prayer time, continue to pray without ceasing. Continue to come before the Lord with your requests. Continue to bring your requests before the Lord. Pray without ceasing. And then Hebrews 4:14-16, pray with confidence. Pray with confidence. I like Hebrews 4:16-17. And it says this, let us therefore, you know, since Jesus is making intercession for us, right? Let us, verse 16, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and grace to find help in the time of need. You know, he says, let us come boldly to the throne. You know, I do a devotion every week, and at the end of the devotion is a prayer, and the prayer is introduced by this phrase, let us go to the throne of grace. Let us go to the throne of grace. Let us go to the throne where God sits on high.
But yet and still, he hears us here. And he listens with an ear to hear our prayer. And so the writer of Hebrews says, let us come boldly. You know, that don't mean that you stick out your chest and say, I'm here. But it means with confidence. Let us come confidently to the throne of grace, knowing that God hears us. And what does it mean to persist in prayer? It means to pray in the will of the Father, pray without ceasing, pray with confidence, and then pray in faith. Even when you don't feel like it, and when you don't see an answer. Even when you don't feel like it, and you don't see an answer, you got to keep on praying by faith. I love Hebrews 11 in verse 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Let me rephrase this. Faith is the substance when you get tired and you don't see any results. It's the evidence of things that it looks like is never going to happen. That you got to continue to have faith, and you have to continue to pray. That's what it means to persist in prayer. It says about Abraham that he was not weak in faith, but he was strong in faith. And so you got to have strength as you come to the Lord in prayer. What does it mean to persist in prayer? These are some of the things that it means. How long should a person persist in prayer? Well, can I say this? I'm going to give you some answers, but can I say this? I don't know. Right? I'm going to be honest. You know, you ask me how long you going through something, how long should you pray? I don't know. But let me give you some guidelines. Number one, until God answers and turns it into a praise. You know, if God answers it and it turns it into a praise, then you can stop. And you can start praising him for what he's done. All right? Keep on praying until God redirects your prayer. Right? If you're seeking God and you're seeking his will, God may, sometimes James said you pray and you have not because you're praying amiss. You're praying off the mark. Maybe sometimes God has to come and make an adjustment to your prayers. And then I shared with you the story of one of the ladies of our church, Sister Dolores Howard, how she prayed for her husband, and she died and went home to be with the Lord, right? And shortly after she died, her husband got saved. So sometimes, saints, you got to pray for the rest of your life until they, you know, somebody said, man, you know, the first time that I came to church, I got baptized and they put water in my face. And the second time I came, I got married and they threw rice in my face. I'm not coming back to church anymore. And the preacher said, you can come in one more time, and the next time they're going to throw dirt in you. Until they throw dirt in your face. Right? You got to keep praying until they throw dirt in your face. Right? And then you might get the glory and find out that your prayer was answered. Hallelujah. All right. And then let me close with this. And that is, what are the benefits of persistent prayer? First of all, let me say this. When you pray and nothing's happening, in the Bible it says that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And I'm going to ask that you keep that slide up because I don't have that in my notes. So I'm going off the slide here today. All right. 1 Corinthians 15, 58. Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. That your prayers are not in vain. You know, God hears your prayers. And if God is hearing your prayer, that means that they're not in vain. And the thing is, you just got to keep on persisting in prayer. You know, you got to keep on pushing the rock. Even though the rock might not be moving, keep pushing the rock. Because God said push the rock. The second thing, you will reap the harvest of your prayers. I don't know how. You know, again, I'm being honest with you. I don't know. I don't know how, But I got to believe that if you've been faithful in praying for something time after time after time after time after time again, year after year after year after year, if you've been consistent in prayer, that somewhere along the line, you are going to reap the harvest of your prayers. Yes. I don't know what it is, right? I don't know what that looks like. But, you know, sometimes we just got to have faith and believe what God says. Amen. And then we cannot see all that God is doing. You don't know what God is doing while you're praying. Seems like nothing is happening. But God is at work. God is doing something, even though you can't see it. And you just got to persist in prayer. And then the Lord, as I said earlier, look, if nothing else, what's that? Proverbs 15, 8. If nothing else, the Lord just loves to hear your voice. He just loves to hear his people come to him and cry out unto him. He loves to hear the voice of his children. You know, and I would ask the question, is your voice strange to the Lord? That, you know, when you hear your kids and you can hear the different tones and the different sounds of their voice, you can hear their voice and you know who it is, right? And so if there's another child that you've never met before and you hear his voice, then who that? Who was that? But when he hears his children call on him, he delights in that. Look at this. The sacrifice is of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. The prayer of the upright is his delight. God loves to hear your voice. And so, perseverance in prayer. We've talked about the commitment to praying. We've talked about the model prayer. How do you pray? And today we've talked about perseverance in prayer. Let us go to the Lord. Father, we come to you today. And we thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. And the blessing that you have given us as far as prayer is concerned. And Lord, you not only told us to be committed to prayer, you not only gave us a model prayer, but you told us to persist in prayer. Keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. So Father, I pray that as we come to you, as we talked about last week, our Father, that we can pray to you as our Father. We have a privilege, Lord, to pray like the unsaved can't pray. They can pray to God. They can pray to the Creator. But we can pray to our Father. So, Lord, as we come to you as our Father, let us realize that we can persist in prayer and bring these things before you. So, Lord, I ask that you would just speak to our hearts about what it means to persist in prayer. Lord, I pray today that there's someone watching online, someone here today that has never received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And today, they would like to bow their head and bow their heart, more importantly, and say, Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Right now, I ask you to come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. Thank you for doing something for me that I couldn't do for myself. And my friend, if you pray that prayer and you're online, give us a call here at 412-242-3255. Let us know your name and how we can contact you. And someone will follow up on that decision that you made, or if you have a question about salvation, someone will follow up with that question. If you're here in the sanctuary today, you want to know more about what it means to become a child of God, or if you want to join this church
as we give the invitation today, we invite you to come. So, Lord, we commit all these things to you, and we say, have your way. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let us sing.